Learn Your Prospect, welcome to RTB 2021 for September 8th, 2021. Hope you're doing well on this day, on this Wednesday. So we got some great text today. We've got 1 Samuel or 2 Samuel chapter 2. We've got 1 Corinthians 13. This is, of course, one of the more well-known texts in the New Testament, often read it at weddings. And then we've got Ezekiel 11, which is a complex but powerful text. And then we have Psalm 50. So why don't we start with, well, let's start with 1 Corinthians. How about that? So 1 Corinthians 13 is, of course, the famous exposition of Paul on the theme of love, the excellence of love. And of course, he describes this as the more excellent way, which is the last verse in chapter 12, as he's discussing the theme of unity in the midst of the use of spiritual gifts and how we should be unified as a body of Christ in the use of these spiritual gifts. Keep in mind, this whole section in the book of 1 Corinthians, in this letter of Paul, is urging the church at Corinth to have order and unity and a lack of division in their worship. And of course, part of that worship is the exercise of these spiritual gifts that the Spirit sovereignly gives to individuals upon salvation. And they were using these gifts ultimately for their own purposes in dividing the church. And so Paul comes and says that really what should govern our use of the gifts is this one character trait of love. And keep in mind, in the Old Testament context, and in the New Testament context, I think, love is an action, right? So it is something that's done specifically within covenant relationship to it's an action that is based in commitment and loyalty to individuals within that covenant relationship, even as a husband loves a wife and a wife loves a husband. It is sacrificial in that way, but it is also one that is deep and grounded and active. And this is the way ultimately Paul describes it, right? That love is patient and kind. It's not jealous, does not brag. It's talking about what love does and doesn't do, right? And so there's a sense in which, again, love is this active covenantal expression, expression of covenantal devotion. And so that should govern the activities of the church. Is this more excellent way of love. 1 Corinthians 13. Let's move on to, we'll end with Ezekiel. Let's move over to Psalm 50. So Psalm 50 is something of a prophetic psalm. It has its theme as the theme of sacrifice. It's seen as a kind of a prophetic psalm. It's a psalm of Asaph in that it begins with the mighty one, God the Lord has spoken. So kind of is introduced by this prophetic oracle. And what he declares ultimately is the nature of sacrifice. That God, yes, sacrifice was part of the Israelite expression of worship, but God doesn't need it. And it kind of has a theme that Paul hits on in Acts 17 in his speech at Areopagus in Athens, that God owns the cattle on a thousand hills. He doesn't need anything. And ultimately, God is one who desires something else. And that is, as verse 14 and 15 tell us, he desires the sacrifice of thanksgiving, keeping of vows, and calling upon and depending upon him. That is what God desires. By the way, this is a theme that we see reiterated in the prophets. And so it's interesting that this more prophetic psalm very much has a theme that's similar to that of prophets, like, for instance, Hosea and Hosea 6, 6, Isaiah and Isaiah 1, and then also in the book of Psalms and Psalm 40. So very, very similar themes. And in the next psalm, Psalm 51, which reads, since we're here, you do not delight in sacrifice, otherwise I would give it, but you're pleased with what? A broken spirit and a contrite heart God will not despise. So God is more concerned with the heart and the expressions of devotion than he is the actual act itself. our acts of piety should be tied to heart obedience, right? And something that arises from within us, a change of heart. And speaking of a change of heart, we'll get to that in just a minute with Ezekiel. 2 Samuel 2. Remember that now Saul is dead. David has received news of this, and so he's going to begin. Really, the next few chapters in Samuel are about how David consolidates his power, and he begins, of course, where David is from, and that is from Judah. And of course, Judah is significant because Judah was the one to ultimately produce the king and ultimately the Messiah. Judah was also, of course, the chief tribe in the southern portion of Israel. And so he is ultimately made king over Judah at first, that southern tribe, a very large region, really ending at Jerusalem and then going southward, if you look at a map. But there's the issue of Saul's, the people who are in line with Saul, who are loyal to Saul, are not too pleased with this, right? That now Saul is dead, they're going to try to keep control, including Abner, the cousin of Saul, who's commander of his army. And then you have Ishbosheth, who is Saul's son. And so they make him king over the northern kingdom. Now, David is centered at Hebron, which is in the south. Jerusalem at this point in time is not controlled by the Jews at all, by the Hebrews at all. And so the capital is there at Hebron. In the north, you have the northern tribes controlled by Saul still, or Saul's followers, including Abner, the commander, and Ishbosheth. And what follows is a very bloody and bitter civil conflict between these two individuals. It kind of ends with nothing necessarily being resolved. You have Joab and the forces of David fighting with Abner and the forces of Saul. And it ends with this kind of unstable truth here at the end of this chapter. And so anyway, most of this is just this history about how God is ultimately bringing David to be in control over all of Israel. And this will play out further once we get to chapter 3 of 2 Samuel. Moving on finally to Ezekiel chapter 11. Now, this is one of my favorites for Ezekiel. It's a great chapter, but it's very complex. So it starts with another vision of Ezekiel where he sees, it probably even predates some of the things that we've already read, but he's seeing the turmoil that's within the kingdom of Judah at the time, specifically in the palace. You have Zedekiah, who is the last king of Judah, who is being advised very poorly. He was installed, Zedekiah was, by Nebuchadnezzar in order to kind of keep control over Judah. And Zedekiah is being advised to rebel against the Babylonians. And this is going to end very poorly for them. And so here is Ezekiel foreseeing the sword of the Lord coming against Judah and against that kingdom. And the question then becomes, verse 13, will you bring the remnant of Israel to a complete end? Is this the end of Judah? Is this the end of your people, O God? Alas, Ezekiel cries out. And then God answers that in verses 14 through 21. And he promises them that God promises them, Ezekiel, that he will restore his people. He will give them ultimately a new heart, is what it says here. So this becomes a theme in the book of Ezekiel. Ezekiel 18 and Ezekiel 36 talk about this. I actually preached on this when we were going through the various metaphors of salvation earlier in the year, and we talked about the metaphor of the new heart from Ezekiel 36, and here's that metaphor being played out here in this text at the very beginning of the book of Ezekiel. And so God will give them a heart, and this heart will cause them to do something. It will cause them to walk in his statutes. In other words, cause them to walk in right covenant relationship with God. And then they will be his people and he will be their God. That's the verse 20 is the kind of the covenant formula. In other words, they'll be restored to right covenant relationship, but it only comes when God gives them a new heart. Of course, we know when this happens is in the new covenant, when under Jesus, who gives us that that new heart. And then at the very end of this chapter, we have a very powerful scene in which that glory of God comes back into play. So we kind of had a pause on that for just a little while in this chapter. The glory, remember, had gotten up out of the temple and left. And this chapter tells us where it went. It went to the Mount of Olives. It says it goes up to the out of the midst of the city and goes to the mountain, which is in the east of the city. That's the Mount of Olives, which is unique in that it is the mountain that actually is higher than Jerusalem, overlooking the city. Some of you, if you've been to Israel or at least seen pictures of it, have seen pictures from the Mount of Olives. Some of the iconic pictures of the Dome of the Rock, which sits on the Muslim holy place and structure that sits upon the Temple Mount these days, those pictures are taken from the Mount of Olives. And of course, this was, I think I mentioned this at a, I think it was a Good Friday service a few, maybe a year or two ago, where we talked about, not a Good Friday service, Easter sunrise service, that's what it was, where I talked about the experience I had when I was in Israel. Because, of course, the unique thing about this glory of God getting up out of the temple and going to sit on the Mount of Olives is that when the glory leaves the temple, it's never said to come back. So even as the Israelites rebuild the temple some 150 years later under Zerubbabel, and this is, of course, in the story of Ezra and Nehemiah, in the books of Ezra and Nehemiah, even as they rebuild, specifically the temple, the glory never returns. Ezekiel, at the end of his book, will prophesy of a new temple, and it prophesies of a return of the glory of God, but in history, that never happens. Even as Herod rebuilds the temple in that majestic temple of Herod, the glory never returns until Christ comes to the glory of God once again, made manifest. We beheld his glory, John tells us, verse chapter 1 of his gospel of John. We have beheld his glory, the glory of the only begotten of the Father, filled with grace and truth. That's when the glory of God returns. And I told the story at that sunrise service of the day that I was in Jerusalem, sitting on first century steps, going into the city of Jerusalem, steps that Jesus would have walked on. And I looked over at the Mount of Olives, and it hit me that glory of God that had went and taken position on the Mount of Olives to watch the destruction of the city of Jerusalem, that glory of God never returned until the glory of God returned walking up those steps that I was standing on to go into the city. And he went into the city for one purpose, and that is to sacrifice his life for me. And I was giving a devotion that day to the people who are with me on that trip, to students and others who are part of that trip to Jerusalem that day. I became pretty emotional just thinking about that sacrifice of the glory of God made manifest in the person of Jesus Christ. And just thinking about the sacrifice that he made for people like you and me. It's a beautiful chapter here in Ezekiel 11, one fulfilled very completely, I think, in the person of Jesus Christ, because when he came, when that glory of God came back in the person of Jesus and sacrificed his life for us, you know what he gave us? He gave us this new heart that we needed, the heart of stone that we had replaced with a heart of flesh. And because of him, he is now our God and we are his people. So, Ezekiel 11, great chapter. Hope you have a great rest of the day on this day, September 8th, 2021.